the kin of another hazing victim in Nueva Ecija also seeking justice. The lifeless body of 18-year-old Ren Joseph Bayan was brought home Sunday by two alleged frat men. The grade 11 student allegedly took part in the initiation rites of the Tau Gamma Phi fraternity on the same day. Bayan was one of the seven individuals subjected to hazing, but he was the only one who died due to traumatic injuries, especially on his thighs. Authorities are now planning to file charges against six individuals, including the two men who brought Bayan home. His relatives also urging those involved to face their crimes.
Halos gumuho po yung mundo ko nung nakita ko yung bata na nakaganyan yung kamay niya, na wala na talagang buhay. Sabi ko, anong nangyari? Bakit ganyan yung bata? Sabi ko, ganun. Bakit ilang oras na yatang patay? Wala man lang nagtumatawag sa amin. Isang barangay kami, bakit nila pinabayaan yung bata? Yun lang po eh. Bakit nila pinabayaan yung pamangkin ko na magkaganyan? Mas matanda sila. Mga 30s, dapat may alam sila.
Anak ko ako na lang sana! Yung anak ko, anak na maray-maray!
A Manila court convicts university fratman behind the 2017 hazing death of a law student, Horacio Castillo III. The pursuit for justice of the family of the University of Santo Tomas law freshman culminated Tuesday with the sentencing of the 10 Aegis Juris members to life in jail. The same court junked the suspect's petition in 2022 to dismiss the criminal charges against them for lack of merit. The court gave weight to the statements made by Mark Ventura, an Aegis Juris member who turned state witness. 22-year-old Atio Castillo died of hazing-related injuries after joining the Aegis Juris initiation rites. The university, which vowed justice for Castillo, later on expelled the students. This incident also prompted the Philippine Congress to ban all forms of hazing in fraternities, initiation rites in 2018.
The guilty verdict is a team effort. We all placed our 100% and we got our conviction. At this point, I would like to say that I'm holding University of Santo Tomas responsible for the death of our son. It has been proven that Aegis Juris has been practicing hazing. And it's time to check your policies and your laws in the school. The civil law department, the dean himself, failed to protect our son.
It's about time heads should roll in UST.
The 2025 race for over 18,000 elective posts kicks off in the Philippines, and in Makati, a conflict looms within the family of former Philippine Vice President Jejomar Binay and his daughter Nancy runs, as his daughter Nancy runs rather, for mayor in a potential showdown with her brother-in-law. Meanwhile, Quezon City Mayor Joy Belmonte guns for a third consecutive term. Katrina Domingo with the story.
A festive atmosphere welcomed Senator Nancy Binay as she filed her certificate of candidacy for Makati Mayor early Tuesday. She brought with her an official nomination from her father, former Vice President Jejomar Binay, who is also the founder of the United Nationalist Alliance. Proof that she is the anointed mayoralty bet of the family patriarch who established a stronghold in the Philippines' second wealthiest city.
Sikat ang Makati sa pagpo-provide ng basic services sa mga constituents niya. So yun yung kumbaga i-enhance natin at pagagandahin. Number one, I guess, yung how do we use technology to make it more efficient, transparent. So isa yan dun sa programa na gusto natin.
But the lawmaker's voice cracked and tears welled in her eyes when she was asked about her ties with her younger sister, incumbent Makati Mayor Abigail Binay. Mayor Binay's husband, Makati Representative Luis Campos, is expected to compete with Senator Binay in Makati's mayoralty race.
Malungkot, di ba?
Seems like you're hurting.
Ah, kasi pamilya pa rin kami, di ba? Sa akin, hindi ko kalaban ang kapatid ko, hindi kami magkaaway.
Former Makati Mayor Junjun Binay says Nancy has been trying to reach out to Abby since 2023, but the siblings were still unable to resolve their friction.
Si Ate Nancy was trying to reach out to her. Parang hindi tayo malagay sa ganito. Hindi nangyari.
This is not the first time that members of the Binay family will compete against each other. In 2019, Abby and Junjun competed against each other for Makati Mayor, further driving a wedge between the siblings. Despite political squabbles among the Binays, Nancy and Junjun assured the public that they will still support Abby's senatorial bid next year. In Quezon City, incumbent Mayor Joy Belmonte and current Vice Mayor Gian Soto filed their COCs for re-election, marking their tandem's third consecutive bid to lead the Philippines' wealthiest and most vote-rich city. Belmonte and Soto filed their COCs in the presence of their respective fathers, former House Speaker Sonny Belmonte and former Senate President Vicente Soto III, two political titans who started their government careers in Quezon City decades ago.
The first term was a pandemic term, so ako naman ang maasa wala ng pandemya sa third term at lahat ng mga plano natin smooth sailing na may sasakatuparan natin.
In Navotas, Congressman Toby Tiangco and his brother, Mayor John Ray Tiangco, are also running for re-election. The elder Tiangco sibling is also the campaign manager of President Ferdinand Marcos Jr.'s senatorial slate in the midterm polls.
Siyempre, gusto natin mas maraming oportunidad, mas magandang serbisyo, makapag-aral lahat, mas malusog bagamat nandyan yung hospital at mga health centers.
Speaking of the president, his relatives, both from his paternal and maternal side, also made their way to COMELEC offices on the first day of the COC filing. Ilocos Norte Governor Matthew Marcos Manotok, son of Senator Aimee Marcos, hopes for another 3 years as governor, with his aunt, Cecilia Araneta Marcos, as his vice governor. In Tacloban, House Speaker Ferdinand Martin Romualdez filed his COC for re-election. His son and his nephew are also vying for public posts. Ferdinand Martin Romualdez Jr., the son and namesake of the speaker, seeks a seat in the city council, while Raymond Romualdez, the son of Tacloban Mayor Alfred Romualdez, will run for vice mayor. In Zamboanga del Norte, Dapitan City Mayor Bulet Halosos filed his COC for governor. Former Senate President Vicente Soto III says it's not surprising that the usual political names are still front and center during elections.
The number one quality of a good candidate is experience. The second is that you have a track record.
Soto will file his COC on October 2 as he launches his Senate comeback under the administration's slate, Alianza para sa Bagong Pilipinas. Katrina Domingo, ABS-CBN News.
Now, Super Typhoon Julian left a trail of destruction in several provinces in northern Luzon. The entire Ilocos Norte has been placed under a state of calamity due to significant damage to agriculture, infrastructure, and businesses. At least one reportedly drowned during the onset of the storm. In Batanes, even houses made of stones were not spared by the storm. Several landslides were also reported in the town of Uyugan. According to the Provincial Disaster Management Office, this is the first time their evacuation centers were filled with more than 2,000 individuals seeking temporary shelter. The province is also set to declare a state of calamity. Now, based on the latest monitoring of the NDRRMC, the number of affected individuals due to Julian is now at over 119,000 in the regions of Cordillera, Ilocos, and Cagayan Valley. Let's get an update on the weather now from PAGASA forecaster Lori De La Cruz. Good morning, Lori.
Good morning, Bettina, and to our viewers and listeners. Julian weakens into a typhoon as it continues to move slowly. The center of the eye of Typhoon Julian was estimated based on all available data at 280 kilometers west-northwest of Itbayat, Batanes. Its maximum sustained winds is up to 165 kilometers per hour near the center and gustiness of up to 205 kilometers per hour. It is moving northwestward slowly. With this, tropical cyclone signal number 1 is still raised over Batanes, Babuin Islands, the northern and western portions of Ilocos Norte, and the northwestern portion of mainland Cagayan. Residents in these areas are still advised to take precautionary actions because they can still experience gusty winds due to Julian and also heavy rainfall due to the outer rain bands of Typhoon Julian. Meanwhile, here in Metro Manila and the rest of the country, we will experience generally improving weather in the coming days. That's the latest from PAGASA. This is Lori de la Cruz.
Thank you very much for that update, Lori.